Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's my turn to do the settlement meeting talk today. And I'm a bit nervous, so bear with me, whānau. First, I would like to read the scripture taken from Romans 6, verse 23, in the New Testament. Quote, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The topic of my talk today is the unconditional love of Christ. Never forget that you are a child of God, our eternal Father, now and forever. He loves you, and the church wants and needs you. Yes, we need you. We need your voices, your talents, your skills, your goodness, and your righteousness. Because we are all spirit children of God, everyone has the divine right, nature, and potential. Each of us is a beloved spirit, son or daughter of heavenly parents. This is our identity. This is who we really are. Our spiritual identity is enhanced when we understand our many mortal identities, including ethnic, cultural, or national heritage. This sense of spiritual and cultural identity, love and belonging, can inspire hope and love for Jesus Christ. What is it about true love that touches every heart? Why does a simple phrase, "I love you," evoke such universal joy? Men give various reasons, but the real reason is that every person who comes to earth is a spirit, son, or daughter of God. Since all love emulates from God, we are born with a capacity and desire to love or be loved. One of the strongest connections we have with our premortal life is how much our Father and Jesus Christ loved us, and how much we loved them. Even though a veil was drawn over our memory, whenever we sense true love, it awakens a longing that cannot be denied. Responding to true love is part of our very being. We innately desire to reconnect here with the love we felt there. Only as we feel God's love and fill our hearts with His love can we truly be happy. God governs the universe by love. To bring about His eternal purposes, God instituted laws to govern His children. Sin is the willful breaking of the law. God's justice requires that a penalty be paid for every sin. All of us sin, and therefore are fallen and subject to justice. Because we are fallen, we need of an atonement. We have a need of an atonement. All of us would suffer an everlasting physical and spiritual death without Christ's atonement. Because of us, sin Because of our sin, we would have remained subject to the devil forever without the atonement of Christ. Only Jesus Christ possessed the qualification and attributes necessary to perform this infinite atonement. As the only begotten Son of God, the Saviour inherited the capacity to suffer for the sins of the children of God. The Saviour was free from personal sin. The Saviour had power over death. By his means of divine attributes and the power of the Father, Jesus accomplished the infinite and eternal atonement. Jesus submitted himself to the will of the Father in performing the atonement. The atonement was an act of pure love on the part of God, the Eternal Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ. The atonement made by the Saviour began in the Garden of Gethsemane and ended in the empty tomb. The Saviour descended below all things in taking upon him the sins of the children of God. The suffering he endured by the Saviour was beyond what any mortal could endure. The infinite atonement affects worlds without number and will save God's children except for the sons of perdition. The atonement harmonizes the laws of justice and mercy. Mercy cannot rob justice. Justice is satisfied by the atonement. And thus mercy can allow our souls to be cleansed through repentance. Jesus stood as a mediator or intercessor for all of the children of God in satisfying the demands of justice. The atonement of Jesus Christ is essential for the salvation of all of the children of God. The Saviour overcame physical death and secured the resurrection for all the children of God. The agony and suffering of Christ made it possible for all of us to escape eternal punishment if we repent. The atonement of Christ brings everyone back into the presence of God for judgment. We must all do the will of the Father and Son to receive the benefits of the atonement. The Saviour came to save all who would obey him. If we do not keep God's commandments, we must suffer for our own sins. Mercy is extended to those who keep God's commandments. If we could truly understand the atonement of the Lord Jesus Christ, we would realize how precious is one son or daughter of God. As a result of Adam's transgression, mortals were separated from God and would be forever unless a way was found to break the bounds of death. This would not be easy, for it required the vicarious sacrifice of the one who was sinless and could therefore take upon himself the sins of mankind. Romans 6, verse 23, and I quote, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." What is this thing called the atonement? the Saviour's precious birth, life, atonement, in the Garden of Gethsemane, suffering on the cross, burial in Joseph's tomb, and the glorious resurrection assures us all that someday we too will follow him and experience our own resurrection. What peace, what comfort this great gift is, which comes through the loving grace of Jesus Christ, the Saviour and Redeemer of all mankind. Thankfully, Jesus Christ courageously fulfilled the sacrifice in ancient Jerusalem. There, in the quiet solitude of Gethsemane, he knelt among the gnarled trees. And in some incredible way that none of us can truly comprehend, he, the Saviour, took upon himself the sins of the world. Even though his life was pure and free of sin, he paid the ultimate penalty for sin. Yours, mine, and everyone who has ever lived. His mental, emotional, and spiritual anguish were so great that it caused him to bleed from every pore. And yet, Jesus suffered willingly, so that we might have the opportunity to be washed clean through having faith in him, repenting of our sins, being baptized by prayer and the proper authority and the proper priesthood authority, receiving the purifying gift of the Holy Ghost by confirmation, and accepting all essential ordinances. Without the atonement of the Lord, none of his blessings would be available to us. And we could not become worthy and prepared to return and dwell in the presence of God. Jesus Christ was filled with unfathomable love as he endured incomprehensible pain, cruelty, and injustice of us. Through his love for us, he rose above otherwise insurmountable barriers. His love knows no bounds. He invites us to follow him and partake of his unlimited love, so we too may rise above the pain and cruelty and injustice of this world and help and forgive and bless. I know he lives. I know he loves us. I know we can feel his love here and now. I know his voice is one of perfect mildness, which penetrates to our very center. I know he smiles and is filled with compassion and love. I know he is full of gentleness, kindness, mercy, and a desire to help. I love him with all my heart. I testify that when we are ready, his pure love instantly moves across time and space, reaches down and pulls us up from the depths of any tumultuous sea of darkness. Sin, sorrow, death, or despair we may find ourselves in, and brings us into the light and life and love of eternity. I'm so grateful for the sacrifice of our Saviour for me, a sinner, that I might be able to live again and I might receive the blessings that he has given us. I know the church is true. I'm grateful for being a member. I'm grateful for my family members who love me and look after me and take care of me and who are there for me. I pray the Saviour will bless them, keep them safe, especially the ones we truly so dear and we truly love and who our true love is in our heart. Please, Heavenly Father, look after them. for we love them so much. The church is true. We should follow the teachings of our Savior Jesus Christ. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.